And we looked at Mark, I think it was 12:30, it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And that's the first commandment. So I want us to think about these three series like a tripod. So upward series, man, we did one sermon, right? We did two sermons, right? We did three sermons, all those three things we just talked about, and then we did the fourth one. Now, you notice your relationship with God, man, boom, you're skyrocketing, you're getting strong, but then it's not quite complete yet, just your relationship with God. Then we moved on to inward. Not the inward, but inward, like inside me. And that was verse 31. It says, and the second law is like this, that you should love your neighbor as yourself. But before we ever get to neighbor, we realize that it's impossible to love others until you first love yourself. And so we talked about emotional health, and we talked about pain cycles, and we talked about all the things that make you, emotionally healthy, and that when we call this emotionally healthy spirituality. And that's really good stuff. So if you think about it like two legs, you know, we're looking pretty good. But if you think about it like a tripod, really still, you still are incomplete. And I feel like God works in triplets. I don't know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that kind of thing. But so I think there's a third part of it. So we talked about that. Okay, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength is your body, obviously, mind, soul, heart, spirit, so all those things. And then you have to learn to love yourself. So if you have self-hatred, if you don't have an ironclad identity, the devil's going to be like, oh, you're a loser. And then what happens, right? Or, oh, no one loves you. Oh, man, he just, like the cat with the laser pointer, remember? And every time you go for it, But once you get an ironclad identity, you're like, uh-uh, I am solid on the rock of Jesus, and I'm solid. I got ironclad identity. You can't move me, right? But there's still something missing because, yes, now that we've learned to love ourselves, now we can learn to love our neighbor. Now that's the third piece, is loving your neighbor as yourself. And he says these are the two greatest commandments. And if you can do these, man, no storm, any storm can come at you, anything's going to come around, and it's going to be solid. You're going to get a really good shot. It's going to be awesome. So anyway, so I'm just going to put that, let's think about that. So upward, inward, and now this is the windows to the house. This is our it's upward, inward, and now we're looking outward. This is the tripod. So, let's see here. He says, our relationship with God is directly affected by how we treat other people. So we might be really strong upward, right? But if we are not, and we might even be strong inward, but if we are not strong outward, then our relationship with God, the first one, will start to crumble like that. You say, Porque? Jesus, now, guys, I'm telling you, I just want to ask you this question. What if Jesus is actually as serious about these verses as I think he is? I mean, if he's as serious on these verses, these should scare the crap out of you, by the way, okay? It should terrify you. Okay, so Matthew 25, Jesus literally tells people he's going to throw people in hell because of how they treated each other. It says this in Matthew 25:41. Then he will say to those on his left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared not for you, but for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you didn't give me any food. And I was thirsty, and you didn't give me any drink. And I was a stranger. You didn't welcome me in. And I was naked, and you didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison. You never even visited me. And these people will be so surprised, like, man, I had my quiet time every day. I had upward was strong, and my identity was ironclad. What are you talking about here? And he says, they'll say, when do we see you hungry and thirsty, a stranger, naked or sick and in prison, and we didn't minister to you? And he will answer them, saying, surely I say this, as much as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. As long as we can figure out, as long as we can ignore who the least of these are, then we can put that out of our conscience. We don't have to worry about, at least that could be anybody, whatever. Until we really, and I dare you to start digging into who are the least of these and who is my neighbor. And it says in verse 46, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, But the righteous on the right hand will go into eternal life. Now, God couldn't be that serious, could he? I mean, he couldn't be that serious. Like, I prayed a prayer, man. I nodded my head at the altar. I said, yes, Lord, I'll do it. And all that. And I served him. I had my quiet times. I was at Palace Coffee. I was reading my Bible. I took Instagram pictures. I was real, man. But to the least of these, how we treat people directly, so outward, how we treat people directly affects our relationship with God. Someone say, 420. 420. Someone say 420. 420. All right, let's go to 1 John 4:20. That says, if someone says, hey, I love God, but he hates his brother, guess what? He's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, I can see you, Tristan. If I don't love you, then how can I love God who I cannot see? And this commandment we have from God, that he who loves God must love his brother also. Well, I love him, I just don't like him. No, that's not love. That's not love. You're hating. In fact, the translation of the word hate is to love less, to be cool, as in cold, indifferent. Someone say 420. See, our love for God is directly evident. You can tell how much I love God by our love for one another, how we treat one another. That's how you can tell who's really a Christian or not. He says this is basically the fruit on the tree. And we'll get into that a little bit later. Talk about others. Someone say others. Matthew 6:15 says, but if you do not forgive others, when they have trespassed against you, when they have sinned against you, then your Father will not forgive your sins. Think about that. What if, and I'm not saying that God is serious about this, but what if he meant that? I mean, I know God wastes ink and just says a lot of crap he doesn't mean, but what if he actually means that? I mean, I know it wouldn't apply to you. I mean, it's for everybody else. But what if that actually meant that was to you? And if you can't forgive, but Mike, you don't understand. Bad things have happened to me. I know. And bad things happened to him too. And his beard was ripped out. And while they're nailing him to the cross, he's yelling out, forgive them, Abba, for they don't know what they're doing. He says, so when were you hungry and thirsty and naked and sick and in prison and we didn't feed you? To the least of these, how we treat people directly shows or evidences how our relationship with God really is. And if we say we love our brother or love God, but we hate our brother, then we can't call ourselves Christian. And if we can't forgive people their sins, then he can't forgive us of our sins. We gotta get outward. And when we're dealing with outward, we're dealing with other people's instabilities. So with God, man, he's dealing with our instabilities and our flakiness and our crazy crap. And when we're dealing with inward, we're dealing with our own flakiness and we're like learning not to hate ourselves. But now, once we got that, you know, now we got to start dealing with other people's business, other people's problems, right? And they might not be nice. And so my boy George W. Bush, my boy recently said, we judge others by their worst examples, but we judge ourselves by our best intentions. We judge others by the worst thing that they did, but we judge ourselves by, well, I didn't mean to do anything wrong. Well, did they mean to do something wrong to you? John 13, Jesus said this, John 13:35, by this all, everybody, all, will know that you are my disciples if, someone say if, you love one another. And if you don't love one another, guess what? They're not going to know that you're his disciples. In fact, when you start talking bad about somebody or start gossiping about somebody, they're going to say, I thought you were a Christian. And they may say it out loud or they might just keep it to themselves and be like, I thought he was a Christian. So cool. So our outward life is very much connected, as it were, to our inner life and our upward life, right?
And only the three of these come together to make something stable that the wind and wave can't take down. So cool. That's awesome. Outward. Someone say outward. But what does it look like to live and to love outward? We're going to be spending the next couple of weeks in Romans 12, 9 through 21. And so I want you to look under your chair. There's a piece of paper there. Now, every morning I get up, and this has been on my fridge for a year or two. And this is Romans 9, or 12, 9 through 21. And man, it's like every one of these bolded things punches you in the face. You know, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Do not take revenge. Live at peace with everyone. If your enemy's hungry, feed him. Give him something to drink. And the last verse is really good. We're going to break this down over the next several weeks, the next 3 weeks, tonight and two more nights. This is what we're going to call outward. And I was like, Carrie, where did this thing come from? She's like, I made that. And I was like, oh, man, you're awesome. I'm going to give this to everybody because these phrases punch me in the face, and I want to punch them in the face. And so I want them to receive that same punch in the face. It's a good punch. It's a punch that you're like, oh, Jesus, that hurts so good. The very last line there before the address, Romans 12, says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So I want you to take these home. You can bring them back. Put them on your mirror. Do whatever you got to do. Read these. Let them punch you in the face every day. This is how we live outward. And in fact, by doing these things, we get closer upward. This will be the next step in your upward phase, is to get closer to people outwardly. So what does it look like? 21, do not be overcome by evil, because evil will come in like a flood, and it will try to knock you off your feet. And it seems like when there's so much evil, I mean, I remember I was watching Lord of the Rings and King Theoden was sitting there and the orcs are coming against Helm's Deep, and they're beating on the walls and they're blowing things up before they even have bombs, and they're all like in the back in the castle keep, and they're knocking down the doors, and he sits against one and he's like, what can we do against such evil? What can you do when such evil is trying to overcome you? You have to overcome evil with good. You can try it any other way, but I'm telling you, it's not going to work. You can try to figure it out on your own, but I'm telling you, it's not going to work. You have to overcome evil with good. Tonight, we're just going to cover verses 9 through 13. I'm going to do a different kind of sermon than I normally do. I normally do a topical sermon. Tonight, I'm going to do line by line. This is what you call a textual sermon. This is where we're going to go exegetically. It's a big word. That means I know what I'm talking about. through the words. Okay. So first, before we get to verse 9, we have to set up the occasion. Someone say the occasion. The occasion basically just means, why is he saying this right now? What happened before? Who's he talking to? All that kind of stuff. It's what we call context in hermeneutics. Another big word that tells you I know what I'm talking about. All right, so so the occasion is this. The verses 1 through 8, Paul is just talking about the body. You guys have probably heard this 100 times. We're one body, but we have many members. The eye is not a hand. The hand is not a mouth. You know, every piece of the body does a certain specific, unique function. And together, we all join together to make one body, and it makes a difference, and it's all good, and it works together. But how crazy is it when the eye looks at the hand and says, "You're an idiot. I don't do things like you do them." And the hand's like, "Well, you're dumb. You're just soft and mushy. You can't do anything. I can hold a hammer. What can you do?" And he's like, "I can see the hammer." And it's just like these ministries are like, "You're dumb. We just have an acoustic guitar. And if you have lights, you don't have the Jesus." And we're like, "Well, if we have all these lights and all these electric guitars, and if you don't have an electric guitar solo, then the Holy Spirit can't even come down. What are you even doing?" And then other guy's like, no. If you have instruments, you are not of God at all. And then the other guys are like, Listen, if you're not swinging around incense, you are totally missing out." And it's like the hand is telling the eye that he's stupid, and the mouth is like, "You're all idiots." You know, and the ear is like, "No, I don't, that's not what I'm hearing." That's dad joke. All right. So that's the occasion. He's talking about how we are to be one body and each member holds unique value. Someone say unique value.
Unique means that we're not like each other. We're all together. We're one body, but we are different and we're unique and we have different things that we bring to the table. Each member does its unique function. And without each member, we'd really miss out. If you lost a pinky, and I don't know if you've ever stubbed your toe, and all you can think about for like a week is that freaking toe. Or a hangnail. You ever had a hangnail? Or ever had like a canker sore or something? Holy crap, you're like, man, is this ever going to go away? I'm in so much pain and misery. You don't realize how important things are until you lose them. Each ministry on campus holds a significant piece to the puzzle. So here we're going to pick up right after that passage about the body in verse 9. And it says, love must be sincere. Okay, that almost speaks for itself. So I'm just going to move on and spend some more time in other places. I'm going to kind of skip over a few things because I think it's a little bit obvious on some of them. But love must be sincere. Obviously, it must be sincere. Have you ever experienced insincere love? And how did that make you feel? Okay, so obviously, love must be sincere. Let's move on to the next phrase. Hate. Someone say hate. What is evil and cling to what is good. That seems pretty black and white. Let's break that down. Hate what is evil. Hate means to abhor or to have a horror of. I'm like, ugh, I don't like evil. It's like, oh, I hate evil. I hate it. It's good to hate. Someone say it's great to hate. Oh, I don't think you all said it. You've been trained against that word, haven't you? Society has told you something about that word, hasn't it? Don't say it's great to hate. I'm telling you, it is biblical to hate. Who is this cult leader? It is it is biblical to hate. The key is you gotta hate the right things. Evil. You gotta hate evil. You don't play patty cake with the devil. I remember mowing my yard, and I had a riding lawnmower, so that's how I mow. You might have mowed like this, but I mowed like that. And we had fields, and I'm mowing fields. And I just became a Christian, and I'm like, I wonder if the devil could get saved. I kind of feel sorry for the devil. The devil should have a chance to get saved, too. Shouldn't he? Why is God being so wrong to the devil? And I was like, what is wrong with you, kid? See, I had the wrong idea. I was beginning to get the script flipped. Hate what is evil. It's good to hate. You got to hate the right things. We have to learn to hate sin so bad. But we don't really hate sin, do we? We keep going back for more of it. If we had actually hate sin, we hate it and its effects and what it does to people. And every time you click on that picture of that girl, it's causing somebody to get held up in sex slavery. If you would learn to hate sin, learn to hate. I hope you learn to hate. Don't play patty cake with the devil. And I don't have time to go into this general sense of good and evil. So actually, I'm going to look at the context of hate what is evil and cling to what is good. There's a context to this. The word evil here, it could mean general evil or general good, but actually the context tells us that it's actually talking about something a little bit more specific. Evil here has a reference to unkindness. Someone say unkindness. So rather than evil in general, through all the research that we're doing, we found that evil in this specific instance is talking about unkindness, and it's linking unkindness to evil. Paul says that we need to cling to what is good, or in this sense, we need to cling to kindness, that we are to be kind to all people, and specifically to the ones called brother. Now, there's several different rings. Tonight, we're only going to talk about inside the church, and then we're going to work our way out to enemies and people who persecute you. But tonight, so don't stop there. Oh, no, we're supposed to love just our own people? No. We're supposed to love everybody, but tonight, we're only talking about inside the church. So, and you'll catch on to the context of this as we go. Paul says that we need to cling to what is good, or in this sense, kindness. We need to cling to it. Hold on to that. That we are to be kind to all people, and specifically, we are called to be kind to brothers, meaning other Christians, people inside this body, people inside of other ministries, the church in general, that's what we call brothers. Several rings out. Okay, so evil equals unkindness. Someone say evil equals unkindness. And here's some other ways that this is also used. The same word is used in Matthew 5:39. But I say to you, do not resist the evil person. Someone say evil. This is meaning the mean or unkind person. Don't resist the mean or unkind person. It's not talking about they're inherently evil like the devil, right? It's actually talking about their actions, their kindness, their lack of kindness, their unkindness. So do not resist this evil person. Whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn to the other also for him to strike your other cheek. Psalm 34:14, depart from evil and do good. Well, if we took that in a general sense of good and evil, that's kind of nebulous. We don't really know what that means. But then we look at the next thing. This is how we know it's talking about kindness and unkindness. Seek peace. Peace. This is talking about kindness and unkindness. Evil here is talking about unkindness versus kindness. We know that because of the word peace. Psalms 97:10, hate evil or hate unkindness, you who love the Lord. Hate it. Get to a place where that whatever is unkind, you hate it. That is not cool. Someone say, not cool, man. And then, okay, so that's the first part of the equation, is to hate what is evil, hate what is unkind. One thing that's unkind is not telling somebody when they're about to get hit by a bus. Whenever the world says, no, what's kind is just accepting everybody, letting them walk wherever they want to. What's true kindness, what God says is kindness, what his North Star and his Bible calls the kindness is like, whoa, dude, whoa, you're about to step out and get hit by the bus. If I was unkind, I'd be like, yeah, live however you want, do whatever you want. Bam! Not very kind, I didn't warn them. That's not kind. Kindness looks different in reality than it does in 21st century America. Amen? So hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Cling means to be joined to. And actually, the Greek word means glued. Be glued to. Cleave. As another verse says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and will cleave unto his wife. Be glued to his wife. Be joined to his wife. Leaving and cleaving, right? This verse says we are to be glued. Okay, so someone say, be glued to kindness. So this is my first point tonight, and I normally only do one point, but I'm going to do several points tonight because this is a textual type sermon. So the first thing I want you to remember is to be glued to kindness. Be glued, cleave to kindness. Be glued to kindness. Why would we have to be glued to kindness? Because unkindness is so powerful. It has the potential to just sweep you off the boat. It has the potential to sweep you away into a flurry of saying words you don't mean. Has that ever happened when someone's been unkind to you? It's like this tidal wave just boom, knocks you down, and this flurry of unkind words come back in response, right? Is it just me, or is it you? I'm having to cling to this thing is sweeping me away. A flurry of unkind words coming out of your mouth. I don't even know if my mommy knows that I talk that way. You become someone you don't want to be, or you strike back in revenge, or you just get swept off the deck of the ship. Let's cue this video real quick. There is a thing called a rogue wave. I don't know if you've heard about this. I just learned about it yesterday. Yeah, go ahead and hit the button. It's all good. Boom. This is a rogue wave. So normal things are just kind of going along and bam! All of a sudden, this huge wave with tons and tons of metric pressure per square foot comes on. Now, this is from Deadliest Catch. They're just doing their thing, and bam! All of a sudden, out of nowhere, this big wave comes and knocks them out. Here's another one. They're just doing their stuff and, you know, just throwing the whatever down there. And here's slow motion. All over the bow of the ship, tons of metric pressure all the way up. We're talking 30-something. And then here comes another one off the other side. Boom. And what they call these, and it's sweeping people around. It's throwing them everywhere. So the thing about a rogue wave, if you do your research on it, is that it comes out of nowhere. Life is, and how much you know that's just like life. Everything's going, you know, fine. And all of a sudden, oh, man, it just happened out of nowhere. And this wave comes along and boom. Now, let's say that that wave is unkindness. And you're just going along and then just somebody, you know, flips you off or something. I don't know. Or something. It's like this wave. And you, if you are not glued to kindness, you're going to get swept right off the boat. Now, in one of these deadliest catch videos, a guy gets his foot broken in half because he's like up on the thing. He's just doing his thing, you know, on the crab box cage, yeah, thing. Vessel cage thing. And this wave goes boom, and his foot's in there and just boom, breaks in. You're talking about tons of metric pressure. Now, when something unkind happens to you, it is almost that exact same thing. Your flesh immediately will get swept away unless you are tied down and glued, cleaving to kindness. Amen? Yeah. So, let's move on to verse 12, or 10. Be devoted to one another. So let's go back. Be glued to kindness. Someone say, be glued to kindness. Okay. The next one says, be devoted to who? One another. What's the context of this? The church. Your people. Be devoted to each other. That's what the Bible's saying that we're supposed to do in love. And then honor others above yourself. Let's break that down. Be devoted to one another. Devoted, the Greek word means cherishing one's kindred. Someone say kindred.
Kindred.
Too bad Cooper's not here tonight. The night I use his word, kindred, he's not here. It says, cherishing one's kindred, especially parents, children, fond of natural relatives, faithful, loyal to one another. And this context is talking about towards other Christians, that we are supposed to be devoted to one another. Does that set off any red flags straight off? Why would he say be devoted to one another? Because we live in a day when we've been told that we are supposed to hate the church. In an effort to be relevant to loving outsiders and people who don't go to church, we have actually bought into the lie of letting the pendulum swing to the other side, and we started to believe that we're supposed to hate the church or make fun of the church, or, yeah, I'm not really about those guys. Or, yeah, well, that was just the Catholic Church and the Crusades. And it's like, listen, if you've been around for 2,000 years, you're going to make a mistake too once or twice. We're pretty new on the block here, Protestants, so, you know, don't be too hard on our Catholic friends. You know, like we should be devoted to one another. Like this picture here, which I think is probably one of the greatest lies. And whoa, it was a good lie too, because this guy got so many people saying, "Yeah, I hate church too. I don't even want to go to church and everything." It's like, wow, you sound so right, but you're exactly wrong. Because anything that's contrary to the Word of God is wrong, and the Word of God says that we are to be devoted to one another. And all this video did was make people say, you know what, I don't want anything to do with church. I don't have to be, it's my own personal relationship. Look, I got upward just fine. I'm just fine on my own. I don't need anybody else. And that was the greatest lie. The devil's like, yes, good job. You did such a great spoken word. You made so many people believe you. And they got swept right off the ship. And they got isolated. And when they got isolated, I divided and conquered them. They're dead. They're not even following Jesus anymore. Be devoted to one another. Someone say, be devoted. It calls us, the Bible calls us the body of Christ. Turning against ourselves is just as stupid as cutting our own hand off. It's just stupid. Don't do that. It calls us brethren. It calls us the family of God. When I was a kid, my older brother, who's just the middle brother, Marlon, he was into Terminator and RoboCop. He was so into them, man. Like, he had a fantasy world in his head, and he would walk around like RoboCop. And so kids made fun of him. We're talking junior high. Loved RoboCop. Kids made fun of him, and they even beat him up. And this caused him to turn and become very harsh and mean in his older in life, and very off on his own. But during this time, when he was still soft, he was walking around like RoboCop. People beat him up. And my brother Stephen, who's 5 years older than me, so he's a couple years older than my middle brother, because he was so embarrassed by my middle brother Marlon, he would join in with them and make fun of him. Because he didn't like everybody making fun of his brother, and he was connected with him, right? Family. And so he would turn with the others and make fun of my brother. This caused my brother to just crumble and become very lost. Be devoted to one another. Sometimes we make friends with people on the outside of the body. This is good. We're supposed to be outwardly focused, right? We're supposed to find people who don't know Christ. This is great. And then they start making fun of the Wesley or people in it or Christians in general or whatever. Maybe it's even, like I said, the Catholics who have a long history, you know, and they've had a lot more chances to make mistakes, but then they've righted a lot of their mistakes. And but people will make fun of them, and atheists especially, man. Oh, what about the Inquisition? What about this? What about the Crusades? It's like, oh my gosh. And if we're not careful, we will turn on our Catholic brothers. We will turn on other churches. Well, that's not us. We're not the Baptists. Oh, we don't do that. Oh, we're not the Church of Christ. We're not like that. Oh, we're not this. We're not doing that. Be devoted to one another. Can somebody say amen? We are the body of Christ. And how crazy is it that as I was looking up this word faction meaning different groups of people, that's the word that where we get the word heresy from. That's where we get the word heresy from. And so many people are worried about believing just the right thing, and, oh, you guys believe a little different. You must be a heresy. Oh, that's a heresy. Oh, that's a heresy. We're so worried about heresies that we've let the division actually, the very thing that heresy actually is division. Cause us to be divided and actually become the heresy rather than what you believe. If we're inside the framework of the Apostles' Creed, we are Christian. You don't have to worry about it. Anyway, that's another sermon for another day. So when people start making fun of the Wesley, we'll just start there. And we sit by and we don't say anything. Now, are we supposed to get defensive? No. The answer is no. You can say no. We're not supposed to get defensive. But just standing by and be like, oh, well, I'm not a part of those guys. Is that being devoted to one another? No. Thank you. All right. We got somebody who's still with me. Thank you, Dadrian. Happy birthday. When we sit by and say nothing, when we watch as they beat up on our brothers and sisters, like my brother did to my other brother, we let them divide us from them. We say, oh, no, man, no, Cody Darty, he's cool, man. It's everybody else, you know. And if Cody's like, yeah, I mean, everybody else, they're the weirdos, you know. I'm cool because I want to be in with you guys. He's just cut our legs out from under us. He hadn't done that, by the way. He's really good about not doing that. No, what are you supposed to do when they do? No, you're cool as heck, man, but all those guys. No, you say, no, I am one of those guys. So now, you don't like us? Oh, no, I like us. Dude, have you met any of them? Well, I saw a couple of them in class one time, and they were loud in a movie theater one time. Have you actually sat down to have a conversation with them? Well, this might sound like it's being a little bit snarky, but it's like you're really calling them out, and they need to be called out. Right? We're not, you know, they need to be called out. It's like, have you had a conversation? No, I haven't had a conversation. You actually read those standards of leadership for yourself? Like, you read them? No, but somebody told me that if you don't get a mentor's permission, you don't get to date somebody. That's actually happened. I've actually had people say that, and I'm like, did you actually read that rule yourself? So you're actually believing something that somebody said, oh, okay, that's fine. And then they feel stupid, and then it's like, well, let me introduce you to somebody that's really awesome. Come on, let's go. And from there, you don't just leave it at, oh, yeah, I'm not one of them. The Bible says be devoted. Someone say be devoted to one another. The next line says honor one another above yourselves. Now, we're still talking about inside the church, one another. honor one another above yourself. This means to esteem your brothers and sisters highly. The second phrase, above yourself, means this. How many times do you make a decision on where you're going to go and what you're going to do and who you're going to invite because of your agendas instead of thinking about other people and maybe what they need? And maybe they're lonely. I had a friend named Renee, became a Christian. She was Muslim, became a Christian. She led so many people to Christ, but I sat with her many times as she would cry herself to sleep because no one thought to invite her to things, ever. The very people she would be pouring out to would go off and go on their own little thing and do their thing, and she would be left with nobody. I thought, how crazy is this? How crazy is that? Honor others. Lift up others above yourself. It's the hardest concept to get through Eli's head. But I'm telling you, the younger you are, the more immature you are, the harder it is for you to share, right? And instead of thinking about how much fun I'm going to have with this group that I perfectly crafted, that's going to be perfectly fun to be with and know that guy, right? Clicking it up. Now, I've always said, I don't mind if there's cliques as long as everybody has one and as long as they're open to outsiders. But when we start getting closed off, that's whenever it gets real ugly. Honor others above yourself. When I was in the world, me and my friends, it was like we were on this king of the hill. We were just trying to fight to see who could be on top and who could be the best and who could be, you know, better than anyone else or whatever. And when I became a Christian, I finally found a group of people where instead of trying to fight to get to the top, they were like, say, hey, come on, let me lift you up. I'm like, what is this? What is going on here? People lifting us up. What if we became such a community? And this happens, but sometimes we easily fall into the flesh because kindness, unkindness sweeps across the deck and we start trying to cling to our own self instead of cling to what's good, kind. What's kind is to say, yeah, let's just lift other people up. Let's keep on bringing honor back. Someone say, bring honor back. See, our culture dishonors honor and honors dishonor. And I preached this several years ago in a sermon series about David. We dishonor honor, and we honor dishonor. If somebody comes up and is like, man, my pastor's so awesome, blah, 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 they're like, whoa, you're way into your pastor, man. Like, you need to lead, like, cutting him down or something. And it's like, but on the other hand, if you say, man, I don't agree with everything Mike you said, now all of a sudden, now we've dishonored, right? Now everyone's like, yeah, okay, all right. See how our culture has dishonored honor, and we honor dishonor, and we dishonor honor? It's crazy. Let's bring honor back. So let's go on to verse 12. Or 11, sorry. We're in chapter 12, verse 11. This is another one. We're still helping each other out. We're still loving one another. Never be lacking in zeal. Someone say, zeal. But keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. There's a lot here. Zeal. How does your zeal help the rest of the people in this room? Anybody? You feed off it, right? Whenever you see, like, Tristan getting it over there, like, man, he's worshiping Jesus, he's going for it, man. Now I'm like, oh, man, yeah. Boom, I'm going for it, you know? When I don't feel like I'm the only one worshiping God up in this place, when I feel like the chorus of other voices, we're in this thing together, there's power in together. Being zeal, having zeal for Christ. Man, that is powerful when we do it together. He says, man, you've got to keep your zeal going. Keep your spiritual fervor going and do it not for others, but do it for the Lord. But know that it's going to help others. Zeal means speed, eagerness, intensity, enthusiasm, fervor. It even means fanaticism. Be fanatic about Jesus. Be crazy about him. Sell everything you got to follow him. Whatever you got to do, be crazy about him. Have zeal. The antonyms are indifference, lethargy, laziness, boredom. If you're bored in your faith, you have lost your zeal. Unconcerned for the lost or for anything. Oh, I go to church, I'm not going to the two bus because I have to. I don't even know why I'm on the leadership team anymore. Maybe today I could just sit down and just blend in. Maybe I could just sit with everybody I know this time instead of meeting other people at Tuesday lunch. I don't really feel like worshiping today. I'll just kind of stand here. I just don't feel, I'm not feeling it because so-and-so broke up with me. And, man, zeal. Keep your zeal. Keep your zeal. Fire it up. Fire it up. God, I'm not giving up until every person on this campus knows you. Lord, I know I could be in 50 other jobs right now, but I've chosen to stay, and I'm not leaving this place until every student has heard the gospel. Amen. You can try to throw me off campus, devil, but you ain't gonna, because I'm not giving up. I'm not giving in. I'm not surrendering. I'll never believe that it's useless. I'm never giving up on my dorm. I'll never give up on my unit. I'll never give up on my floor. I'm never going to give up on my resource team. I'm never going to give up on my mentor ring. I'm going to keep on going until the whole world is saved. It's not useless. We got to keep the zeal. We got to stay alive. We got to have the fervor until we've won the world to Christ. We can't give up. And when you just sit there, everyone else is dragging you along. Say, please get into this thing. That's how you can help your brothers and love and cling to what is good. I'll keep going. I can't stop. I won't stop. And spiritual fervor. The word fervor means fervent, which in the Greek, the word was fervent, and it means to be hot. Someone say, be hot, girl. And it means to boil if it's liquid or glow, almost like a steel, like a sword, whenever you're pounding it and it's like on fire. It is red hot. That is figuratively, or it could be fervent or earnest. Be on fire. That's my third point. Be on fire. Someone say, be on fire. And then it's serving the Lord. The word for serving is actually the word teleu, which means a slave. I'll do anything. I'll do any menial task. I'll be on fire. I'll be hot for God. I'm going to be on fire for him and his message and his ways. I'm going to be on fire for him. And guess what? If he tells me to clean a toilet, I'm going to be just as on fire while I'm cleaning that toilet as I am if I'm out there up on stage doing something important. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, that's the two that balance each other. I'm going to be hot for Jesus if I'm playing lead electric guitar. But if you ask me to do that, well, I'll take my skills somewhere else. Serving the Lord as a slave of the Lord. I've been bought with a price. I am not my own. I'm not calling the shots. I'm not the boss. I'm not telling you what to do with my life, God. I'm asking you what you want me to do, what I should do. And then I'm shutting up long enough to listen to hear what you actually say. And as Cheney said, if you're faithful with a little, then you'll be given much. We're like, no, I've got a degree. I should just be able to have what I want. No, you got to go into that job and be faithful with a little. And when you're faithful with a little, then you'll be given much. Then you'll be given much. Be on fire. Do it for the Lord. Verse 12. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Now, the boys covered this over the last 3 weeks, so there's a lot there I'm not going to unpack tonight. Think about that on your own. Verse 13. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Again, we're still talking about the Lord's people. We're still talking inside the church, the brethren. Share with the people who are in need. Practice hospitality. So let's talk about this. Share with the ones in the congregation who are in need. This means we need to bear each other's burdens financially, emotionally, and otherwise. We need to help each other out. Bear each other's burdens. Pray for each other. That's why we pray on the Phalanx page. Every time someone's uncle or somebody gets hurt or something happens, they're posting on the Facebook page and we're praying for them. That's bearing each other's burdens. And then my very favorite one is the very last one. Practice hospitality. It's at the end of verse 13. Practice hospitality. Now, the word hospitality is my favorite Greek word in the whole Bible. Nursing majors, hospital, comes from this word, hospitality. Hospital, iti. It comes from two words in the Greek. One is philos, which is a close friend. Think about your closest friend and what you do with them and how you react. And when you see them, wah! 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 And xenos, a stranger, a foreigner, a guest. What this word means is we are treating a stranger, a foreigner, and a guest as if they are a close friend. It's talking about inside the body. Is this still talking about inside the body, or is it talking about outside of the body? I think it could be both. Let's talk about outside first, outside the body. People who are not a part of Christ, who are not Christians, they're just kind of, you know, checking out and seeing what we're all about. This is why we do events. That's why the event team is so important. That's why we do the WMAs and fifth quarters and freshman party and maroon platoon. That's why we do all those things. It's why we have a foam pit and a mechanical bull every now and then. Other people think, Mikey, what are you thinking? Shouldn't you be spending more money on Bibles? Shouldn't you be spending more money on Bibles? I'm like, you can download a Bible on your phone now. I'm going to spend $500 on a mechanical bull for 4 hours. Because I know that I'm going to find people who are strangers, people who don't know Christ. And I'm going to treat them like a close friend. Because of that mechanical bull, we're going to have a good conversation. It's worth $500 to me. Couldn't you do it cheaper? Of course I could. But would something cheaper draw somebody who is scared of the church? Probably not. This is why guest care is the most important team that we have. When we do it right, and I believe we're doing it right, but this is the most important team that we have. I'm going to tell you why with a personal story here in just a minute. But because our goal is to make total strangers, people who don't know anything either about God or us, we want them to know that there is a place for them to have close friends, philos. That they belong before they believe, or even if they never believe, that they still can be a part of us. That's hospitality. That's philoxenos. That you don't have to earn your way into be my friend with true believers, or be cool enough, or to dress a certain way, and then okay, now you can be in my circle. No, philoxeno says, hey, I don't know anything about you. You might be on the side of the street, you might be living in a dumpster, and I don't care. I'm gonna hug you in my suit because I'm gonna treat a total stranger, a foreigner, a guest, like a close friend. I love this verse. I love that word. Practice it. Practice hospitality means it's a part of your daily life. It's not just something you do once a week at Tupos. It means you're philoxenos all the time. That as soon as you step into our building or see us on campus, you're treated like a close friend, even when you're a stranger. That's philoxenos. That's for the outsider. Now for the insider, for the person that's already in the body of Christ and or a part of the Wesley or whatever you want to call, however you want to define that, why would we need hospitality inside the body? Shouldn't it just be for outsiders? Well, when you can't know everyone because the church has grown so much, and I guarantee there's people in this room that don't know other people in this room, you can either be suspicious of the other people in the room, and anything they do can set you off, or you can practice hospitality and extend grace to the other people in the room because you haven't actually sat down to have a conversation with them. And I dare challenge you to do this. I challenge you, if you listen to nothing else, listen to this. Besides to be glued to kindness, listen to this. Don't make one judgment about somebody that you have not sat down and had a conversation with. If you're in this room and you're judging other people in this room, or if you've had a bad thought about somebody else in this room because of, that's wrong. And you need to say you're sorry to God first. But you need to extend grace to them. And say, you know what? I'm going to love that stranger as if they're a close friend. I'm going to give you trust before I'm suspicious. I give trust versus suspicion. When you can't know everyone on the leadership team, or you don't know everyone on the phalanx, or you don't know everyone in this room, you have two choices. One, you can do what's normal and just treat everything with awkwardness. Oh, I'm not going to say hi to them. I don't know their name. Or you can do something awesome. We'll say, do something awesome. You face the awkwardness. Man, I'm so sorry. I've met you 15 times. I don't know your name. I'm so sorry. You open yourself up to treating a stranger like a close friend. What if they're weird? I don't know if I want to let them into my bubble, my circle, my clique. What if they don't fit? What if I lose my place in the group because I let this guy into my group? And everyone's like, Mike, you suck. You let that person in the group? No one would ever say that. We're all Christians. We smile. But seriously, we're going to cut him out because, no. One time, years ago, we had a group that like formed and like, we're not letting freshmen in because they're annoying. And I'm like, no. No. Mikey, you just love freshmen. Yeah, I do. I do. I'm going to tell you why. Worship team, you can come. When I was in seventh grade, I was not a Christian. I dabbled with the church, but I turned away from the church. And we're playing hockey. We used to play roller hockey with rollerblades and stuff. It happened to be in the Methodist church parking lot, though I never saw any Methodists, because there weren't many of them, I don't think. But one day, I mean, okay, so if you can imagine the Outsiders, who's seen the Outsiders? Okay, so we were definitely the greasers, we were not the Soch. But the Soch went to the Baptist church mostly. This is small town America for you. And here I am, greaser. These people make fun of you in the hallway, or well, you know what? They probably didn't even make fun of me. Thinking back on it, they probably just never said hi to me. Did I ever say hi to them? No. Start there, by the way. So these girls, popular girls, they come out of the Baptist church. Youth is about to start. It's a Wednesday night. They come over and say, hey, would you guys like to come to youth with us? And we're like, you're talking to me? You're talking to me. Yeah, we would love to come to youth. We go over there. We take our skates off. You know, they leave. They go inside. We go in there. Where are they? Well, they won't say a word to us. We sit in the back. No one says a dang word to us. This is when I'm teetering on the edge of being a Christian or not being a Christian. That night, I got so pissed at God that I started vandalizing churches. This poor church had nothing to do with it over there on the other side of town. I kicked in there with a sign probably five times. I'd just go and vandalize churches because I hated God. You know why I hated God? Because of people. People not extending philozenos. People saying, hey, and I was like, oh, I get it. Okay, I'm a notch in your belt. Okay, you're a good little Christian. You invited the poor greaser to your church. Great. This is what I think of you, God. Break stuff, vandalize stuff. Got to where I was, you know, doing all kinds of crazy stuff, doing drugs, stole a pickup one night, drove it all over the place. All of that stemmed from that night. A girl comes and leads me to Christ my freshman year of high school. I pull her down, so she breaks up with me, and I have a choice, and I decide to follow Jesus instead. So I start following Jesus, and now I'm on fire for God. Boom. Not vandalizing churches anymore. And there's this guy named Jerry. Jerry was a dropout, but he came back to school. Jerry was the guy that said everything on his mind. Oh. Jerry, oh, you really shouldn't say that. Oh, that's gross. Jerry, what are you doing? Jerry was the kind of guy that had a crack, man, that went all the way up his back. And he was working on something, man, you know? And it was like, oh, Jerry. And I'm thinking this as the Soch I gathered giggling. And I turned and I said, don't you ever do that again. Not around me. Jerry, come on, let's go. Let's go get a Coke together. My Christian friends, what are you doing, Mikey? Jerry smokes and he drinks. What are you doing? I'm like, I'm reaching out to freaking Jerry. He's Philozenos, man. Well, Mikey, intervention time, you know, they all gather. Mikey, we're worried about you. We're worried about you. Because of Jerry. You know Jerry. I get Jerry to come to church, and he's dropping F-bombs. I'm like, Jerry, God, Jerry, what are you doing? Stop it, Jerry. And he opens up to me about how his girlfriend and he got pregnant. She had an abortion without him, and it just... He lost his kid. I hung out with Jerry every day my senior year. We'd go get Dr. Peppers all the time. We rode around in his old beat-up El Camino. And every time Jerry did something, oh, it made me feel uncomfortable. I was like, oh, my gosh. Guess what my friends did? You're out of the group, Mikey. Philozenos. So when we go back and we read, do not be overcome by unkindness, but overcome unkindness with kindness, then we have to be glued to kindness or it's going to sweep us off the ship. We have to be devoted to one another. We can't be divided or we'll get swept off the ship. And we have to honor others, esteem them highly. Don't hold back your praise from them. And in fact, do it so much so that you put yourself out so that you can lift others up. Honor others above yourself and practice hospitality. Be philozenos.